Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is TWiT.
Bandwidth for TWiT specials is provided by CacheFly at CacheFly.com. This is TWiT Live Special number 285, recorded Monday, April 25th, 2016, using PhotoCard with Bill Atkinson. Hey, everybody, and welcome to a very special, I'm so excited about this, a very special edition of our show Triangulation. You know, Bill Atkinson was here a couple of weeks ago, the legendary Bill Atkinson, the man who, of course, created QuickDraw, the QuickDraw primitives for the Macintosh ROM. He was really one of the leaders of the Macintosh team in the early days in 84, 83. He then went on to create Mac Paint because he said, well, I've got QuickDraw. I really ought to make an app that shows it off. Susan Kerr, of course, used Mac Paint to make the Mac icons and the beautiful Japanese woman brushing her hair. I mean, these are iconic images. The hello when Steve Jobs pulls the Mac out of the... That's all thanks to Bill Atkinson. And most people would have been content to stop there. But no, Bill said, yeah, I think I've got more in me. What about HyperCard? The program that really changed the world in so many ways, and even Tim Berners-Lee, who created the World Wide Web, said it was an inspiration for him. So we owe Bill Atkinson an awful lot, but he's still not resting on his laurels. So we had a great time, and if you haven't seen the first two triangulations that we put out with Bill, please go back and watch those. They were amazing. But he's come back again, and we're twinsies today.
Do you know the HyperCard was originally named WildCard?
I didn't know that.
It wasn't really centered around the link that takes you to another card. It was supposed to be this software construction kit that people could use to make their own software without having to become programmers.
Which it was.
They can just sort of drag and drop pre-made components and make interactive media themselves. And the reason it got changed its name is that Apple was in a lawsuit with a company that made a hardware card that went in an Apple II that would do nibble copy. It would copy the lowest level format of disks. So it would do a disk-to-disk copy. And that product was called the WildCard. So they didn't want to, they could have bought the license, but they would have had to settle that case. And they didn't want to. So
then, sometimes good things happen for a reason, right? I mean, I think HyperCard is actually a better name because of the hyperlink.
At the time, I didn't like it because it sounded like hype. You know, it's software. Everybody says software is, this is the
overhyped,
best new thing and all. Yeah. Chris Espinosa actually named it HyperCard.
Another early Mac team member.
He was great. I loved working with
Chris
him.
Chris was a hardware guy, right?
No.
Software, okay.
His mom was a main, I think, documenting person.
That's right. And Chris, Chris write a lot of the documentation?
Really young. He was like 14 years old when he came to Apple.
Amazing.
And he's still working at Apple.
Is he?
Yes.
I didn't know that. That's great. Well, Bill is, of course, not working at Apple anymore. You founded General Magic, which was an incubator, as it turned out, for some of the best minds in Silicon Valley, including Andy Rubin, who went on to do Android. And I think the DNA of General Magic is also in our smartphones today, very much so. So we owe you an awful lot. But his latest project, and he says his greatest project, is called PhotoCard. It's an app for iOS. And Bill asked me, and I was very glad to say yes, if we could do a little tutorial on how to use PhotoCard. Which, by the way, Bill, I want to say, since you were on, I had a PhotoCard and I'd used it before. It was an app cap on our iPad Today show many moons ago. But I hadn't really used it that much. And when you came back on, I kind of opened it up again, and I said, wow, there's a lot I can do with this. And I started using it. And now if you get a thank you note from me, it's going to be in PhotoCard. If you ask for an autographed picture, it's going to be in PhotoCard. This is really awesome. So let me show you. This is my Mother's Day card. Bill's going to show us how to do a better job, right, of all of this. These are some cards that Bill sent me. This is the first thing you should understand is when you can send a PhotoCard via email, and that's free. But if you want, you can also have it printed. And by the way, nice, not only beautifully printed, and it's one half of an 8.5 by 11 sheet, right?
Well, so it's postcard. Both post office calls a jumbo postcard.
Jumbo. So it, and it's laminated. This is perfectly, you know, you could put this on the wall, and it's beautiful. And it goes through the mail. It's first class mail, and the stamp, which would be 49 cents, although I see the post office is lowering postage.
Now it's 47.
They have never lowered postage ever, in my knowledge. But
an emergency surcharge expired.
What happened. So that'll happen automatically. And this is an indicia, which means an indicium, which means it's a legal U.S. postage, but you can have your own stamp on it. Bill's nicely chosen my album art for my radio show. And then they get it in the mail. It's already got the barcode on here. And you were clever because you laminate it so the postmark doesn't, there's no printing on here from the post office. It comes out beautifully. So do you want to make one of these? This is your chance. Mastering PhotoCard with Bill Atkinson.
Thank you, Leo.
Thank you.
That's great.
So first of all, and I have to say, this was my initial reaction. Why would we even want to print cards? Everything, I mean, we're all digital now.
So I'm not a Luddite. I love technology.
Obviously, yeah.
And I use it. But I want to not throw the baby out with the bathwater. I think there's some things that a physical printed card delivers that our electronic communications don't deliver. So our emails and tweets and text messages are great for their immediacy, but they scroll right off and they're kind of out of your memory pretty quickly. What I like about a printed card is it has an ongoing presence. It ends up on your fridge or maybe a mantelpiece.
Right.
And it's sort of there each day. You see it. It stays in your sense of awareness. Later, it may get retired to a shoebox where it forms a long-term memory. The cards are laminated so that they'll last, and 50 years from now, they should look just as good. And you should be able to look at those cards and say, each one actually says, sent by sender name on date, using PhotoCard by Bill and Sue Atkinson. That's the only branding on it. I try to keep it really clean. But this memory will last long after all your text messages are gone.
I have to say, I hadn't really thought about that, but the stuff on your hard drive, your floppy drive, your zip disk, nobody's going to be able to read those in 50 years. It's printed stuff that will last. And I completely think I'm taking a lot of pictures. They're stored on Google Photos and Apple's Photos. But my kids are never going to look at those. But I could very well see them going, oh, look, we found a shoebox in Dad's closet. Wow, look at these memories. I mean, haven't we all done that? Look at these memories. And isn't this fun to see these again? And you've framed some. Now, Lisa, my wife, does something really cool because she also likes prints. And she's put in our halls, we have long halls, she's just put a little rail up all along the hall that we can put a photo on, mm-hmm. and we change them periodically. And it's like a little gallery in the house, but you don't have to hang them. So these are going to be on there, a lot of them.
We have a rail like that in our house.
It's a great idea.
In the hallway, as we enter the door, you see this big, long strip, and it's got...
Exactly.
There may be there's stacks of photo cards,
right.
But then there are about 40 of them on current display.
And you change them. So, yeah, it's like a mini gallery. Look at these. You framed them. They're beautiful. Oh, that's really neat. Here, let me show you a close-up of that. That is beautiful. That's you and your dog. What's his name?
Poppy.
Hi, Poppy. Is she a yellow lab? What is she?
She's a golden retriever.
Golden retriever. Of
Very
course
affectionate.
She is. Yeah, she's adorable.
Great dog.
Here's another one. This is your family, your daughters and your wife, Sue. Oh, what a beautiful family. That is so neat. So there's some real value to this.
Some frames made at framesonline.com and other places.
Yeah.
And what I found is normally they have like a plexi.
They have a back.
But because this is laminated, you don't need to have the plexi.
There's no glass needed.
I put the plexi in the back.
I love this.
Keep it stiff, but then you can see the backside of the card.
I love this idea. So you could probably buy these because it's a standard size. You can buy these ready-made.
Well, from this website, you can order them whatever size you want. Eight and a quarter by 5.5, and they come in, I don't know, 4 or 5 days. And
I'm going to buy some. Nice. What's it called? What's the site?
Framesonline.com.
Framesonline.com. And my mom, I've already sent three to my mom. And my mom, who takes pictures, she makes kind of crafty, right now she's making like felted small animals. And she takes pictures of them and sends them to me. I said, Mom, you got to get this. Now, we should explain the app is free. It's PhotoCard. You can get it on the iOS store, and it's great on the iPad, by the way. We're going to show you how to use it on the iPad, but it also works on the iPhone. And then the way it works is emails are free as well, but if you want to send a card, you buy credits.
Yeah.
And the credit, if you buy enough credits, it's about $1.50 a card, right?
Right.
And that includes postage.
Including the 47 cent now postage.
Yeah.
And it's 3 credits to international, which is $2 and a quarter.
I sent one to Australia.
Yeah.
Now, one thing I've noticed is...
You may be disappointed. The Australia Post is a little on the slow side.
Yeah, well, that's one thing because the way this works is it gets... Tell us the workflow.
Okay. It's a really elaborate process to be able to
make. Oh, am I jumping way ahead here?
No, that's fine. So the cards can't just be printed on a little printer because they have to be printed double-sided.
Yeah.
And they have to be printed full bleed. So they're actually printed a 20th of an inch bigger all around.
Yeah.
Laminated the sheets and then trimmed.
Wow.
They're actually printed 4 up, and now with a new bigger printer, it's a Indigo 10,000 printer, they're printed 9 up. Now I can't own that printer. It's at Progressive Solutions in San Jose.
Sure, it's
really good guys to work with.
Very expensive printer. Yeah.
And so it's printed, then the whole sheet's laminated, and then they have to be trimmed into individual cards and put in trays, sorted into the U.S. and the international ones.
Right.
And the trays are taken to the back loading dock of the main sorting station in San Jose.
Right.
What I found is there was a lot of damage happening to cards. First, because we weren't laminating them.
So right.
We fixed that by their Mylar laminated. That protected them against a lot of sorting damage. But usually mail comes into something called a facer canceller machine. And they dump hoppers of mail onto a conveyor belt, and it flips and flops them using machine vision. And a lot of damage happens there. Well, facing is a matter of getting them all oriented the right way with the stamp in the upper right corner. So what we do is we deliver trays that are already faced.
So they don't have to run it through that machine.
And then using this kind of postage, this is postage by Indicia, which has
a unique
serial number on each one.
Right.
So if you were to drop this card that's been through the mail, and guess the one got mailed, if you were to drop it back into the mail, it would get rejected because they've already checked off that serial number.
So you can't resend it.
Right.
I bet the post office loves this, though, right? This makes the automation very straightforward for them.
They like
it
for a couple of reasons. One is they don't have to print the stamp.
Right.
Right. And they get full retail postal value. I buy these blocks
47
of serial
cents,
numbers
they get
for
the
47
money.
Cents a piece.
Yeah.
But they also like it... Every card has an intelligent mail barcode on it with an 11-digit zip code in it.
I like that. When I enter the address in, it automatically looks up the address, adds the extra 4 digits, so it's got the zip plus 4, and then prints out this barcode. So their machines can read that.
The barcode that is shown in the app is a dummy. They're just a placeholder.
Uh-huh.
And likewise, the postage here is actually a dummy.
Right.
So it says 0 cents there. It's not really going to be zero. But when I download the orders from the PhotoCard server and lay out a big PDF, then I'm going to apply an 11-digit zip code and generate a real intelligent mail barcode. And I do second-level address correction in order to do that. So you'll get live correction. I didn't used to have the live correction in the app, and I found that over 20% of cards were not deliverable as addressed.
Right.
People don't really get addresses correctly.
Right.
Most of your communications are emails or phone calls or texts and things.
We're not very good at this anymore.
Right. Yeah. So what I found is that it helped if you enter an address in the app, I actually go out onto the internet, look that up, check it, and warn you if it doesn't look like a good one.
Well, for instance, I notice it says United States on the app, but you take that off.
Yeah.
On here.
So why do I put...
Yeah, why do you do
why
that?
Why do I have it say United States here?
Yeah.
The reason is, so they're all going to be mailed from San Jose, California. They don't need that United States.
Right.
And in fact, they will be, when they're printed, they won't have the words United States on
them.
But if I didn't put that, a lot of times people would send one, say, from Germany to Germany, and they would leave off the country.
Right.
And so they would think, well, you know, in their country, they don't have to put Germany on
it.
But it's going to be mailed from San Jose, California, so it has to have Germany on it. So by putting United States there... That's really to protect the person who is trying to send it to Germany, make them realize, oh, they need to put the country name in.
So this is going to be about an hour to show you some of the ins and outs. And I have to say, I've been using this for weeks now since you were here, and I'm still discovering stuff. I asked Bill when he got here two questions, and he said, oh, well, you do this. Oh. So I think we need to get into this is going to be a tutorial for people who want to use this better. I just wanted to make sure people understood the value of this right up front and why you would want to do this. And just try one, send one, and see what the reaction is. Everybody I've sent these to, the reaction is phenomenal. They really love getting these cards.
Well, that's really my intention here.
Yeah.
It's of nurturing a heart connection. I've nothing particularly wonderful about postcards, but I think when you can make someone smile and make their heart warm, that's something good. And we live in a world where there's so much fear-mongering and so much hate and so much... What's newsworthy is terrorists.
Yeah.
When you send a mother a card to your mom, it's not newsworthy.
Yeah.
But it is real. And it is what happens in the real world.
Yeah.
So I think people are basically good. I'm trying to give them tools to warm people's hearts. Now, one way to do that would be to send a Hallmark card. You go down to the store and from a rack of cards, you pick out one and you sign it and you send it. But I'm hoping to create something more personal. That when they get it, it's not just you chose that card and signed it, but you actually made something yourself with your own images, your own taste, your own. It's something that when they get it, they'll cherish it much more than a Hallmark card that they would kind of put back in the envelope and put in a drawer. This will actually go. Because it's a postcard, it'll go on their fridge, and it'll be call it fridge-worthy art. It's lowbrow compared to my nature photos.
Fridge-worthy, yeah. Well, you should see the prints of your nature photos that Bill brought another one by. Oh, my gosh.
My beautiful canvas prints are $1,200.
Yeah.
This is $1.50 delivered.
Yeah. And so, by the way, I feel like you're giving us a deal because I can't. This is this. I've tried printing these for myself as souvenir cards. We give people autographs and stuff on appearances, and they're more expensive than that. So I have a feeling I'm getting a kind of a deal on this. Let's get people started.
Okay.
So, and I want you to follow along as we do this. So if you have an iPhone or iPad, go right now to the App Store, and we're going to look for PhotoCard by Bill Atkinson.
Right.
And download that from the App Store. It's free to download. And everything we're going to do here, you can do for free right now. You'll want to buy some credits so you can actually mail them. But for now, you can do emails of these. You don't have an Android version or a web version
yet.
But you plan to, you hope to.
I definitely hope to.
Yeah. And that's not so much, we got to make this a success on iOS first, and then we can move on. Yeah.
If we can't get enough people using it on iOS, then it's never going to work on Android.
Right. And the reviews, by the way, very, very, very good reviews. So I'm going to give you a 5-star just. I forgot to do that the last time.
So you download the app.
Yep.
And you create an account just with your email and a password.
Okay.
So I've created an account. It doesn't cost anything to create an account.
Yep.
And why do you need an account? That's so that we can sync between your different devices. I have an iPhone and an iPad here.
Oh, that's nice.
Card that I sent from here shows up on here.
Oh, that's really nice.
And a custom sticker or custom stamp that I made on one shows on the other. And credits that I bought on one are available on the other. And in fact, if I bought a brand new iPad, all I would have to do is install PhotoCard on it and sign in with my same email and password.
And all the credits would be there.
All of my sent card history and all of my custom things would be there. All the data would sync to it.
So we've got you signed in. We got you set up with your account. You don't have to give them a credit card yet. That comes later if you decide you want to buy. Actually, you won't have to because Apple has your credit card. So you just buy it through the App Store, the credits, if you need them.
No, actually, when I first wrote this, I used in-app purchase to pay for cards.
Yeah.
And what I found is Apple rejected my app. And they said, so you can't use in-app purchase for physical goods. I believe it's because they couldn't handle taxation or returns. And so I had to reprogram it to buy credits using a credit card or PayPal.
Okay.
And actually, it turned out to be a real blessing for my customers. Because the cards would have cost a minimum of $2 a piece instead of $1.50.
Because Apple would take 30%.
Apple would take 60 cents each and every card.
Right. So now
another,
what you...
Another benefit is that you don't have to go through this rigmarole every time you send a card.
Right.
You just click on a button, okay, saying, yes, it's okay to use 2 credits. And you, most people, after they've been using it a little while, I mean, if you want to try it and you're nervous, well, you can buy 2 credits and send 1 card, and it's pretty much just like paying for it.
Right.
But most people will then go and buy a bunch of credits and send a bunch of cards and not have to be interrupted when they're sending the
That's
cards.
What I did. I bought a couple of 100 credits. And you get a discount by doing that as well.
Yes. You get the best price when you buy 100 credits for $75. There are larger amounts, but you don't get any better prices.
So you can, if you're not still not sure, you could buy a credit for $1. You'll need 2 though to send a card.
Yeah.
So get 2 credits and send yourself a card just so you see what it's like. And it goes all the way up to 500 credits. I actually knew immediately that I was going to want a lot of credits, so I bought 200 credits out of the box because I could see myself using this like crazy. Those credits, as you mentioned, will be on all of your devices. What though? Here's a weird one. What if I want to have 2 different people using the iPad? Lisa said, "Well, can I do this?"
So you can have more than one PhotoCard account on an iPad.
Oh, you can. Okay.
So you can just make a new one, and you can sign out if you go here. If I say,
"An account
settings,
yep.
Sign out."
Okay.
Now. I don't see any of my content.
Got it.
It's all private there. Make another account for her, and now her cards will be kept separate from yours.
That's actually really nice because you can keep your completely your own cards. Because one of the things it does is nice. It saves
like
your
own. You might have a same iPad you're sharing, but you log into a different Gmail account and you see your different emails.
Yeah, that's really. I think that's a nice.
It's
way
also
to do
handy
it.
In schools where they've got an iPad that's shared among quite a few different students. Having an account for each.
Let's talk about, by the way, I noticed, I don't know if the timing is coincidental, but I just got an update to this yesterday. Did you do that just because you knew you were coming in? Because
no,
we're up to 12.
On that anyway.
We're up 12. To 12.1. Does that mean you've done 12 plus versions of this?
Yes.
Wow. So Bill's really been
I've been working
refining
on it for 7 years.
Wow.
Actually,
for a long
7
time.
Years since the first one showed up in the App Store. Which is took a while, about almost a year to get the first one in the App Store.
Nice. All right. So what do you get? First of all, the download is a lot smaller than it was a couple of versions ago, right? You have made this much more compact. So it's not a very big download, which is nice. Nevertheless, you get a ton of stuff, including a bunch of Bill's own pictures. Bill, maybe you don't know, is a accomplished nature photographer, one of the best in the business. In fact, I learned about PhotoCard from another photographer who said, you know, Bill Atkinson's an incredible photographer. You should take a look at the pictures in PhotoCard. And so I downloaded it just to see your images. These can be used, if you want, as your photo in the PhotoCard.
Yeah. So they're all copyrighted images, but you get permission to use them on PhotoCards for no charge.
They're gorgeous. How many images are in here?
There are 220 nature photos.
Wow.
And, the way that the app has recently gotten much smaller, it used to be 161 megabytes, and I dropped it to 31 megabytes. And the way I did that is by using on-demand loading of resources. So if you haven't chosen one of my nature photos, they're not taking any space on your iOS device.
But they do download pretty quickly.
And those that you choose are there on your iOS device.
Right.
And actually, it turned out that stamps and stickers take more space than the nature photos, because they have to be in pings. They can't just be in compressed.
These are JPEGs, so yeah. But
they
look
transparency, so they need to be.
They look gorgeous. Pings. This is the latest thing Bill's been doing is pictures of rocks and minerals. This looks like a painting, but this is an actual cross section of a.
That one there is actually not a cross section, which is an interesting example. Almost all of them are cross sections. That's a whole.
That's like an egg.
It's an egg shaped piece of agate.
And then, by the way, you can find out because. You just tip the I button. It'll say this is a dendritic agate from Madagascar. If you want to know the story of Bill's photography of these rocks, he tells it on the triangulation episode, the last triangulation episode we did together. Really fascinating. So 220 stamps. You also, photos, but you also get a bunch of stickers for every occasion. Where'd you get these? These are fun.
So I had to license them from a clip art agency, and it was pretty expensive. There are 440 built-in stickers.
Wow.
And you can make your own custom stickers. We'll do that in a little bit. Likewise, there's 220 built-in stamp designs. Now, I want to emphasize that the stamp in PhotoCard is a stamp design, not like a A physical stamp, you tear one off and then you don't have it to use again. You can use a stamp design over and over and over again.
Yeah.
But you do have to pay for each card if you want it mailed physically. I wanted the cards to look the same whether they were to email or to postal. Let's say I address this one to your email here. Mm-hmm. Now the stamp looks like that. This is a custom stamp.
The indicia goes away. Wife. Yeah.
It has no postage on it, but... And here, it sort of looks like an address, but really it's not. It's your name and your email and some other things that make it kind of still look like a postcard.
And this comes as an attachment in my email? How do I see this?
Okay, so if I send this to you, see, there's the front of the card. Has
oh,
this
that's
picture
a pretty
on it.
Card. Wow,
the
that's
back
beautiful.
Of the card looks like that. If I send postcard by email, so you go down to the Actions menu and say send by email, it's going to make a big JPEG of the top and bottom
nice.
Of the card.
Very nice.
And if I send that, let's see if you get it over on your side of the room.
It sometimes takes a while
for actually,
me to get email.
Emails are sent using the normal iOS email service. If you look at your in the mail client, you look at your inbox or outbox, you'll see the cards that have been sent.
So that's nice. So it's just a big JPEG. That means anybody can see it.
Yeah,
that's a very easy way to do it. Although
I had to make it so it didn't. Use anything fancy because every email client has got to be able to read it. So it's what they call a simple email rather than a fancy HTML email. A lot of people have their
I turn off HTML. I don't want to see HTML email.
Yeah. Well, and the reason they do that is because when spammers send you HTML ones, when you load that image, it pings their server.
Right.
They know
that's
that
exactly
you're live and kicking.
Yep.
That way they know that you're a good spam address.
Right.
But by sending a simple email, then I don't get blocked by those people that have set that.
This is where we're really lucky to have you because you're obviously a brilliant programmer. You're also a creative artist, and you understand this stuff, and you do the homework. So the fact that you went to the post office and postal consultants and got the postage just right, that you figured out the best way to do this in the email, it's really nice to have somebody like Bill Atkinson writing this software, putting that attention into it. I love that.
I think life is too short to do anything if you can't do it the best way that you can.
Now, is there...
It's so rewarding to
I wish
do
everybody
it the very best way. I mean, the difference between art and commerce is do you want to make it as beautiful as you know how to make it.
Yeah, yeah, I agree. You are making art. Now, we should point out that your wife, Sue, has written a wonderful user guide in here, and it's all in here. But I will confess, Bill, I should have read this user guide, but I wanted to get into it. I jumped into it. And probably a lot of what you're going to show us today, I would have known had I read Sue's user guide.
Yeah, so I think... There are different kinds of people, and some people are really good with manuals. Some people will...
They want the
you
manual.
Press on the question mark, and you get this beautiful interactive user guide. And the first thing it does is it has links at the top. You want to know how to make a custom photo. Touch on that. It'll bring you to that section. And the little arrows here bring you back up to the index. But you can also scroll through it. So some people like to, I'm stuck. How do I do this?
It's good to have
it for
that.
Go to the index.
Yeah.
You jump down to the topic and say, oh, that's how I do that. Other people like to actually read through it. It's compact. My wife has done a great job of expressing the content in a short enough space that people can actually read through it.
Nice.
But there are also people who, no matter what you give them on an interactive guide, they're not going to read it.
Right.
And this is where I think what you're doing with me now, making this video, will be really helpful. Some people learn better by watching how something's done, and then it sticks in their head. And so if I can show people how to use PhotoCard, that augments this guide. The guide is still there if you forget how to do something. But for those who learn better by working directly, interactively, this video is probably going to be the best thing for them.
Well, let's get started. Let's make a new card.
Okay.
I'm ready.
To make a new card,
I'll follow along as you
go
do
down
this.
To the bottom here where there's a little plus that says new under it.
Yeah.
New card. Okay. Erase the current contents.
Now,
so what's that
that's
doing?
Scary. Wait a minute, Bill. I just erased everything.
So on a Mac, when you make a new email, it brings up another window on top. And you haven't lost anything in what you were there.
Right.
That's not what we have here. We have one editing environment here.
Right.
And if you want to make a new one, you've got to clear out the editing environment. And so if you look on the other side of this, the stamp and the message
it's all
and
blank.
The stickers, it's all gone. So it's erased it.
Now, if I've mailed it, if I've sent it, it's saved.
Yes.
So don't worry about that.
In fact, there's even a little trick. Okay. What if you're halfway done making something and you're not really ready to send it yet?
Right. But I want to make a new one.
But you want to make a different one.
Yeah.
Okay. So the trick is address it to your own email and send it. Well, that doesn't cost anything, but it gets it registered in the View Sent Postcards so you can recall it later.
This is a great trick if you want to create a stationery, too. That's what I did. I have a stationery, you know, a standard card I'm going to send out. And so I mailed it to myself so that it would be in that list of sent cards. And anytime I want to create a new one, I just go to that one and load that.
View Sent Postcards is very powerful because you can take any card you've ever sent and you can call it up like this, but you can also touch on it. If you touch on the bottom half, and you say replace.
It loads it.
It loads a copy of that. Now, you're not changing the card you've sent.
Right.
If you want to cancel a card you've sent, you got to send me an email before it's actually gone to the printer.
I don't really want to get married.
Right. But that way, every card you've ever sent is a template for making a new one. So now I could just touch on the address to change it.
That's really nice.
I'll readdress this to Leo instead.
And by the way, it takes that out of your address book, which is nice. So you don't have to do a lot of typing.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
There are three ways you can get addresses in. One is by choosing it from the address book. I can say, okay, let's find Leo.
Yeah.
And
you know a lot of Leos.
Whoa. Here's Leo Laporte.
I'm the bottom one.
Okay. And there's your email. And I can choose that. Oh, are you actually not in my address book? I can't believe that.
Well, we'll fix
Create
that.
Create a new contact. Okay, now you're in my address book. And now I can choose it. You can choose one from recent. If you've recently chosen one, that's what the little clock is. You can grab this one and just say done. So many times you'll send to the same person a number of times.
Right.
So just pulling up recent is very handy. But sometimes you want to send to a person. They're not in your contacts, and they're not somebody you sent to recently, so you have to just be able to type in.
And
so
you can do that
manually.
You can
type in a name, and the only trick about this, so let's say I go to Leo.
Mm-hmm.
The only trick is you have to touch in either email or postal. This card is going to either go as an email, or it's going to go as a printed and mailed, so you touch one or the other of these fields.
Okay.
So you're at
140 Keller Street.
140 Keller Street, yeah. And I'll show you a little trick here.
Okay.
I've just typed 140 Keller, and I'm not even going to type the city, but what's your zip here?
94952.
94952. It will go out to the internet. When I sit done, go out to the internet, look that up, find out that it's Petaluma,
this is such a
and
nice
fill it
feature.
In for you.
And the zip plus four and everything, and that is such a nice feature. That's from the USPS. You just look that up from the Postal Service?
Right.
Yeah.
So
but it does international, too, so there
actually,
must be...
I look it up with a service called Correct Address.
Okay, so it could do worldwide.
No, the address correction is
U.S.
only.
Okay.
The service I use can't handle international.
All right, so we have a blank card. We are ready to...
All right, so making a blank card.
Let's put a picture on the front.
Yeah, so you always have to choose a picture for the front.
Yeah.
And... So the first thing you could choose is a nature photo, and you can choose one of my nature
photos.
Okay. Yep. So you could choose one of those. Or a different thing you could choose is choose a previous photo, one that I have already used before, like this one of the front of your studio.
That's nice because you can...
And each of those, they're very quick because you don't have to do any cropping or adjustments. It's one you've already set up.
So I'm going to choose... This is the photo that I sent out when people want an autograph. I will choose the previous photo that I've sent out before, and this is the one I send out. And so now it's pre-populated with that image. Okay.
And the next thing you could do is choose from photo library.
Pictures you've taken.
Any photo. Let's go to all photos here. Here's a picture of some easels in my living room. I'm getting ready for a talk in Carmel. And I can... So when you do this, you have to be able to crop it. So the blue rectangle represents the printed card. That's what it's going to look like. It's always the same aspect ratio. And I say, well, how much of this picture do I want on there? You can move the little blue handles to adjust the cropping. You can also adjust. There's a nice tool here called cropping mode. cycles between four really common crops.
I didn't know this.
So cropping mode lets you cycle. What if you want to see the whole picture?
Right.
Right, versus zooming in so that you fill the whole card. So fill versus fit.
Right.
And the other is, do you, the four modes, one of them is, okay, portrait versus landscape. So I could say I want it like that.
Right.
And you could still adjust these from there, but just the most common ones, and it'll default to the most reasonable one. If you got a horizontal picture,
it can kind of tell.
Filling the whole card with the horizontal.
Nice.
But what if you have a squarish picture and you would be cutting off important parts? Then you might want to go to cropping mode to say, give me the whole thing, even if I get some gray wings.
So there's a portrait mode, there's a landscape mode.
Yeah.
And then there's a landscape image in a portrait
frame.
Each
of those are fit and fill.
So
either fill the card with the whole image.
Got it.
Or fit so that the whole image fits on the card.
Got it. Okay.
And then let's show an example.
This one's a bad example.
The one I'm using. Choose a portrait one.
Yeah.
Let's choose a portrait one.
Yeah.
Here's a picture of an iPad prototype that I made.
Okay.
And it's a portrait. Oh no, it's a landscape picture. Let me choose a different picture.
You filled in the sides. That's a tricky one.
Yeah.
How about that picture of the guy there with the beard? Yeah.
Okay, this is my friend Otto Bergman.
Hey Otto. He looks like a postage stamp.
Well, actually, he is a fan of custom postage, and he has done that. So if I cycle between cropping modes here,
I see now.
See, normally, so there's so filling the
fill.
Whole card.
Yeah.
And this is saying, I want the card, I want it to fill the whole card as a
portrait.
But you
won't get all of the, you'll lose some on the
edges. Stuff, so then I would go, fit to card.
Fit to card.
And if I'm going to send this as a printed card, that's a perfectly good way to do it.
Right.
Your card is going to come out.
With a little bit of a.
Vertical.
With a little
bit of
some bars.
It'll still be horizontal.
Right.
But if you're going to send this an email, well, then you wouldn't want it rotated. So as an email, then you'd actually want to go to something like this,
where it
stays right upright, even though it's a vertical.
There's a great tip. Okay. So depending on how you're
setting
it.
Depending on whether you're going as an email or a postal card, depending.
Now, I see some other settings. There's an enhance photo and lighten and darken. So tell us about those.
Okay. Let me choose a picture that maybe needs some enhancement. All
right. This here's one. One of mine. So enhance is kind of like in the iPhotos or photos enhancing.
It's exactly like it.
Okay.
So here's a, this is one of the new post office small package sorting equipment.
Okay.
I went to a demo.
You're obviously a postal geek now. You've become one.
You learn whatever technique you need in order to get the job done.
Right.
And so this is, I go to postal things to learn postal things. So if you say enhance, it looks at it and says, can I fix the shadows, the highlights?
It's pretty smart.
It tries to fix red eye if you've got a person in there.
Right.
And on top of that, you can lighten or darken. And there's a trick, okay? Let's say you've gotten way down into darken. You don't know where's the middle again. Where's neither lighten nor darken?
Right.
If you turn off enhanced and then turn it back on, you have reset lighten and darken.
Ah.
On top of the enhance.
And if you keep tapping lighten or darken, it keeps going.
Lighter, up to a certain point. There's like five.
So enhance then turns everything off.
Back to
neutral. So you can go back to neutral. Okay, that's a
great
tip.
So this one, actually, I think it would look better with enhance and maybe one step lighter.
Yeah.
And then you say done, there's your card.
So that's the other thing I have to remember to say done. Same thing on cropping mode. It's not done till you say it's done, right?
Right up in here. You gotta press done.
So don't forget the done. Let's see. I'm going to darken that a little bit, and then I'm going to say done. And you can see now the full size, and you can see if you like it, and you can go back, can't you? You're not stuck with that.
Yeah. So if you want to choose again, just press on the photos thing there.
Okay.
And you can now choose from photo library.
And just pick the same picture again.
Pick a similar picture and enhance it. And maybe this time I won't.
Yeah, I kind of screwed the picture up, so I have to start over.
So once you've chosen a picture for the front of the card, then you can flip to the back. So the flipping is just a matter of swiping from left to right. My advice is to swipe where the address is, because if you had some stickers on here, I'll just put some on for...
Sometimes you swipe the sticker.
Yeah. Supposing I had some stickers on here, if I happened to swipe right on a sticker, I just threw it off the edge. I just deleted a sticker. So it's best because you can never have stickers on the address. It won't let you.
That's smart.
It'll bounce off of it.
Yeah. Everywhere but.
Yeah. It's sort of, I think of it as the opposite of Velcro. It's sort of Teflon. It won't let it stick on there. So if you swipe where the address is, that's a good way to flip the card over.
Got it.
Once you've flipped it over, usually what you'll want to do is choose a stamp design. And there are 220 built-in stamp designs, and you can use those. There's lots of beautiful... Now, here, let's choose the Viking ship here.
Okay.
Now, that's pretty. Now I've got a stamp.
I love that. Yeah.
And we've licensed a lot of artwork for this. And it used to be...
So these are not the stickers. This is something completely different.
The stamps and stickers are different. Stamp, there's a one of on the upper right corner. And stickers... I can have as many as you want, and they can be positioned wherever you want and sized however you want.
Now, we'll show you how you could do custom stamps in a little bit, but these, it comes with a bunch of really great stamps. These are not Postal Service stamps. These are just stamps, bills included for all occasions.
Well, I think of them as stamp designs.
And some of them are your images, obviously, right?
Some of them are my nature photos.
Yeah.
Most of them are ones we've licensed from a clip art agency at great expense because we had to get the extended license. Not the license you would use in an app,
right.
But the license you'd use to be able to enable other people to use it.
Yeah.
So usually about 50 times as much.
They're beautiful. Really? Wow.
And we used to bundle these into
the app. You can have Bill as a stamp.
But we found it by using this on-demand loading, we can keep the app really small and actually make it so that we can add more stamps and stickers without growing the app.
Nice.
It's always been like a pressure about, well, I'd like to add some more stamps.
Right.
But I can't because the app's going to get so big, people will complain.
Can I make a request? I'd love some.
Sure.
For instance, I love this Japanese lady, but you'll have to talk to Susan probably, but I'd love to have the Susan Carey illustration. Probably Apple owns all the rights to all of that stuff.
All right. Let's do that, right?
Can we do that?
Okay. So I'm going to bring in Safari here.
You're going to look for Susan. So you could pull an image in from the internet. Oh.
So I'm just doing a search. Susan Kerr, Japanese.
There she is in Mac Paint.
Okay.
Beautiful.
So I've got this image here.
Yeah.
From Safari, you can press and hold to copy.
Okay.
If you go back in here, press and hold on the stamp, you've pasted it.
Oh, look at that.
Being able to quickly go back and forth. Now, you could have, if I say preview that as a stamp. There's the stamp.
Look at
that's
that.
All it
Watch,
takes to
move
make
your head a little bit over there. Yeah, there we go. Yeah. Oh, that's nice.
So you could have gone stamp plus, which is normally how you make a new
one.
And
that would
buy a new stamp.
But if
you've got something in the clipboard,
right.
Instead of doing that and then paste,
yeah.
You can go directly by just press and hold, just like you press and hold to
Perfect.
Get copy it.
Nice shortcut.
Crop it how you want it.
This takes advantage of the extra pane in the iPad
Split
Pro, which is really nice.
Yeah. iPad Pro and in the iPad Air 2. That can also do that.
Yeah, iOS
now,
9.
If you didn't have an iPad Air 2, you could still
copy
switch into Safari, mm-hmm. copy an image, come back into PhotoCard and paste it.
Now, if I'm going to use that as a stamp, do I have to buy that image?
When you go to make a custom stamp,
yeah.
you've got to pay a one-time fee to be able to store it on our server forever.
Okay.
There's no monthly cost to store. But you pay when, let's say, I say
it's
preview
stamp. Store
it on
your server so that I can
say
use
buy
it
stamp.
Anywhere. Yeah.
And now
it's two
says,
credits?
You have 568 credits available. This stamp will cost 2 credits.
Okay.
Once you buy a stamp, you can use it all you want with no further cost.
Nice.
So if I buy it, now it's stored on the server. I could use it anytime I want. And if I go to choose a stamp, there it is.
It'll show up. Nice.
In the stamp menu, here's custom stamps.
Nice.
These are custom stamps that I've made.
Nice. Susan, I hope you don't mind.
Well, actually, when you go to mail this, if you're mailing it as an email, it won't bother you.
Okay.
But if you're mailing it as a physical card, I will ask you if you have the copyright permission.
That's a good thing.
Because if that was Mickey Mouse, I wouldn't want to get Disney mad at me.
Right, right. It's on your head then, not Bill's.
And frankly, if you claim you have permission, I won't dispute it. I will take your word for it.
Yeah, that's mostly, I got it.
So in this same way, you can copy and paste. Let's say I wanted to copy pictures for the card.
Yeah.
I could go to a place, a really handy site is...
Oh, I could do the same thing for the card.
Yeah. So here's a site called Pixabay, what I really love. They have a lot of images that you can use. And I'll...
This is nice because I also have images that are on my iPad that are on, let's say, Flickr. And that's really handy because I can get my images from Flickr. That's really
okay,
great.
Okay, so now I'm going to search for, let's say I wanted to do a Halloween party invite.
Yeah.
Halloween scene. And scroll through those and find one that I like. And
so basically any image you can find on the net.
Download that. And then again, press and hold to copy. So after you've downloaded it, press and hold, copy. Press and hold over on the picture here.
Now you're going to tap the picture.
To paste it.
All right, let me see if I can do this. So okay, I've gone to my website because I have some of my own images up there, and I think, oh, I really, you know, I really want to send. So I'm going to copy.
Or is that just a thumbnail?
Oh, you want the full size, right? Well, yeah, actually, because it's Squarespace, it's actually resized that. But let's see how it comes out. And then I flip this over, right?
Press and hold.
And I press and hold. Oh, look at that. Now, it already, I don't even have to say paste.
Maybe you want to enhance it.
No, it's pretty good by itself. Let's see. Oh, look at that. I'm very happy with that. See, that's good. I didn't have that on my iPad. I took it with a camera and put it up on my website. So that's really nice.
So stamps.
That's great.
The card photo, and also stickers. Let's say I'm in Pixabay here, and I say, find me a frog.
You can make your own stickers.
Yeah, find me a frog, and I'll scroll. Sorry, I should stay within Pixabay. Let's go back. I did it the wrong place. It's within Pixabay that I'm looking for a frog.
Right.
And I'll scroll through these, and I'll say, let's see one that I like.
Now, one of the things we're going to show here, which is really cool, is the image editing tools in stickers are very sophisticated. And, well, we'll show you how you can get your own signature into stickers, as well as your own images. And you can even make these images be... transparent, which for stickers is sometimes very handy. So,
okay. So I'll grab a frog.
Frog. There you go. That's a good
now,
frog.
Some of these images,
oh,
you see how it's
transparent
got kind
already.
Of a checkerboard here? That means it has transparency in the image.
Right.
So if I pull that one down and press
copy.
And hold to copy.
Okay.
Now, if I press and hold on the stickers button down in the toolbar here.
Okay, here's a tip. Yeah.
Press and hold.
Yeah.
It's pasted it right
pasted
in.
Pasted transparent. Move over just a little
and
bit.
And
so
you
can see
it's preserved the transparency. So all
nice.
I got to do, I say crop and buy sticker. Now I've got a custom sticker and I can move it around on the card.
That's awesome.
You can tap it to select it and then you can stretch it or rotate it.
But the nice thing is if you have text on that card, because it's transparent, it'll go right under the frog.
Right. Supposing I were to duplicate this by double tap, you see the
they're overlapping. Yeah. Look at that.
Okay. Now, what if you've got an image and it doesn't have transparency in it?
Okay.
So I'm going to go back to here and choose a different frog that...
yeah, I've chosen... Well, I'm going to let you do it because you... So not every image will work, but I'm going to choose an image. This is a picture of my wife that I've got in here, and I want to make a custom sticker out of that. Now, sometimes, how do I make it? I can't edit the mask, so does that mean choose image first or no?
First.
Say again?
You have to press crop first.
Crop it. Okay. Oh, yeah, because I cropped it. Now I can edit the mask on here, right?
Now, in this one.
This one, because it has a lot of detail.
You might want to have, like, just a little rounded corners or an oval or something.
Talking to your mic so I can hear it.
You can use the shape tool down here.
Shape. Okay. Oh.
And choose a shape.
Oh, that's it. This is how you endear yourself to your honey.
So this is very simple. It's not just a rectangle, but it's a shape.
Oh, this is fun. All right. And then what are these other buttons? Should we talk about those or you want to save those for later?
Why not? Why not dive in?
Okay.
I'm kind of making this more complicated than going through everything first and then adding the hard stuff, but it's...
Well, I want to do it in the order you want to do it. So let's not get the complications yet.
Okay. So back to this card.
Let's go back to our card.
All right. Put Safari away, and we've got this card here. And generally what you'll do is choose a stamp. You'll address it. Again, you can address it by typing in or by choosing from your contacts or by choosing from recent.
Right.
Now, notice this stamp up here doesn't have any postage on it. When I choose your postal address and say done, then it adds the postage.
Got it.
Okay, so that's the way you know the difference between
that's not an email anymore. If I had put an email in there, I would never have put the postage on there.
And it wouldn't charge anything either.
Right.
And I wouldn't have to print it and laminate it and trim it and pay the postage and all that. So you choose a stamp, you address the card, you write a message.
Okay.
So I'll just dictate to this.
All right. This is where it's really nice to have a pro and a keyboard. Although, again, we should reiterate, you can do this on your iPhone. You know, you can. In fact, it's really nice. I think really fun as you travel and you're taking pictures of people. If you say, hey, would you like a print of this picture? And they say yes. What I do is I give my phone to them. I say, well, just type in your address here. And I can send them a card on the spot from my iPhone with postage and everything, and just get them to type in the address, and they're going to have the card. And frankly, so often that's what I would prefer to do. What I've done in the past is say, oh, give me your email and I'll send you these pictures and stuff. This is so much nicer. You actually can send them a print right from there. So you've created a message. You just type it in the message field.
Okay.
Yep.
Now, when you've made a message, you can dictate it or you can type. And I'm not sure how you dictate with this. I got a Logitech keyboard on here. And I'm not sure how you get the dictation thing. That's interesting. But you make your message, and then you may want to choose the font for it.
This is amazing.
Now, for PhotoCard, we have licensed over 50 handwriting and decorative fonts, because a lot of people sort of would like to make informal handwritten card, but they don't. If you actually try with a stylus and try to write your name and try to write a decent-sized message, it comes out really horrible.
Right.
It's a bad idea. Better idea to use a handwriting-like font. So I can choose different fonts, and you've got one control on the right that makes the font bigger and smaller, and another one that adjusts the line spacing separately. So you can say, well, I want this big, but I want it closer or tighter together like that. And then when you say done.
That, by the way, remember those sliders, because I forgot, and I said, I need to make this bigger, and I couldn't. And then finally I remembered, oh, there's a slider there, yeah.
Now, if you have a smaller iPhone, like the iPhone 5, for example, and you're in a landscape view, so you only get 320 pixels there, what you'll see is you'll see one of these, and you can touch on the bottom to toggle between the size slider and the line height slider. So when you've got an iPhone in portrait orientation, you can see both.
Mm-hmm.
Or if you've got an iPad, you can always see both. But if you're in a smaller iPhone in landscape, then you can still get at both. But you have to.
I love it. It's very thoughtful that you've considered the size
fonts
of the screen.
Up at the top. So up in the top are the 10 most recent combinations of font size and line spacing.
Yeah.
So that if you've been using this one that way, you can get back to it pretty quickly.
Right.
And yet you can still look through all of the fonts and find one that you like.
You know what you've done, which is great.
There's 300 some odd fonts.
Not only the kind of the standard fonts, but you've purchased all these handwriting fonts you mentioned. So there's some company that makes these, I gather, because there's really a great variety of handwriting fonts that can, some of them can actually look like, your handwriting. Some of them are just like this Janda Silly Monkey, are just fun, right? Snickerdoodle Serif Bold, always a good choice. Is Janda a company that makes handwriting fonts?
No, I'm spacing out.
But you purchased these.
Yes,
which is nice.
I licensed them from. I'm sorry.
That's all right. Viva la vida. That looks like. See, there's people I know who write like that. So that's
So the KG is for Kimberly Geschwein.
Kimberly Geschwein makes
Kimberly
these.
Geschwein makes handwriting fonts, and she has a whole series of them. And
so great.
she's allowed me to license them to put in the app here so that people can use them.
If you want to pretend you have good penmanship, she's got one called Primary Penmanship. It's perfect. But I don't use that one. I like to use the one that looks more like my own handwriting, which is up here, The Great Escape. And what's nice is they know that that's printed, but it feels much more personal because you're using that handwriting.
It's less formal.
Yeah.
It's the more, you know.
Yeah. It's really
so
nice.
Once you've made your message, then you can use stickers. And stickers are signed. Think of it like emoji on steroids.
Yeah.
So stickers, yeah. There's 440 stickers built in, plus you can make your own. And so you can go through these and choose, okay, I want the wine here.
It's Mother's Day coming up, and this is, by the way, a great time to do your Mother's Day cards. And there's a lot of flowers and appropriate Mother's Day stickers that you can, like, here's a nice, I'm going to send my wife some roses.
And you can change the size by tapping on it.
Yeah.
And then dragging on the handles.
Scooching it. Make you
and
it, really
it'll sort of lock in, it's a little sticky when it gets to a multiple of 90.
Ah, so it will print better at those, right?
Yeah.
So that's that little judder it does when it gets there.
But you can make it any rotation you want.
I love that.
And now, here's a kind of a trick that most people, I mean, it's in the, all of these are in the documentation, but.
Who reads documentation? You know that by now. You've been doing this long enough.
So here's the trick.
Yeah.
Supposing I wanted this flipped. I want the
bottle. Oh, yeah, mirror. How do I get it mirrored?
So you shake it back and forth horizontally.
And it flips?
Yep, it just flipped. And now I got the bottle on the right.
Let me do that. I made a sticker of Lisa, that little heart sticker we're talking about here. So let me see if she could be waving that way, or I could shake her, and now she's waving. Oh, this is so fun. This is so great.
Now,
I love it.
Another use for stickers.
How do I get rid of one real quickly?
Drag it off the edge, and it'll go poof.
Just throw it away.
Yes.
Oh, that's nice.
So if you drag one off the edge, you can see as you get close to the edge, it disappears.
Yeah.
If you let go while it's disappeared, then you get a poof sound.
But it can also come back if you said, oh, I didn't mean that. That's nice. It's
before you let go.
Yep.
Once you let go,
it's gone.
But even if you want it back, it'll be your near and recent stickers anyway. The top recent sticker will be the thing you just did.
Nice.
Okay. There's another use for stickers.
Yeah.
Which is to put secondary photos on the other side of the card.
Oh.
I've done that with your sticker of Lisa.
That's really is a photo, isn't it? But
right.
I didn't have to put the heart shape around
shake,
it. Yeah.
Make me a new sticker, and we'll choose an image from our photo library. And let's say I want this picture of one of my canvas prints, and I'll crop it how I want it, and then I'll say buy a sticker. Now I don't have to put a shape on it.
Right. It's just
in that case, I get a rectangular sticker.
And you can make it big.
And I can make it as big as I need.
Oh, that's nice. So it's like a double photo card now.
Right.
Yeah.
So you can have photos on the front and the back.
I can't wait to travel and do this because you could send yourself pictures from your trip.
Yes.
But also send people postcards from your trip. Now, one thing I noticed... And if you're going to send a Mother's Day card, for instance, it looked like about 9 days, 8 or 9 or 10 days to get the card from the moment that I sent it to the time you print it, it gets sent to the post office and then got to my mom on the East Coast is about 9 days. So if you're going to send a Mother's Day card, now would be a good time to do it.
Right. In general, if you're going to the West Coast, you want to be conservative. You should allow a week.
A week.
If you're going to the East Coast, you'd allow a couple more days.
Yeah.
We're trying to get that time down. I actually now track the intelligent mail barcodes on every card that gets sent, every time it gets scanned.
Right.
So I know this card, okay, this one got to Detroit, and now it's, you know, and I know each of the places.
You know where this, it's like a trace route. You know where the slowdowns are, yeah.
And actually, I even use that to fix problems. Like when I see that one has been stuck in Chicago for 5 days in the same place, can't really tell the USPS to go find that card and fix it,
right.
But I can easily send a reprint.
Oh, interesting.
And often
so you'll
the reprint
do that?
Will get there before the first card does, and the customer won't even
That's
know.
That's nice. That's
but
nice.
The cards are important. They have to get there because they mean something to somebody
right.
receiving that. I mean, you're sent this Mother's Day card. You want to know that your mom got it.
Right. Right.
And so
that's a nice additional feature. People are saying, well, why do I have to pay to make a sticker? Well, this is, I mean, the app is free. And so making a stamp or making a sticker is basically a little way of kind of supporting
development. We have to store that sticker on our server forever.
Right.
And we don't charge you anything per month.
So that's what, because we can log on no account on another computer, it's got to be on the server.
Right. I'll open up PhotoCard on my phone here.
Right.
Which has been asleep all this time here. But if I go to View Sent Postcards.
Put it right there so we can see it.
There are cards that I've been
sending. Put it right
here
and we'll be able to see it. See, they can't see it. So put it right there.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah, that's okay.
So View Sent Postcards, and I'll say, show me this one.
The one you just did. And it's already there. Yeah.
And there it is.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's nice.
Or if I say, open up a, choose a sticker, there's stickers we've been, here's the custom sticker that I just made for this. Shows up here.
That's fast. Wow. That's nice.
And likewise with custom stamps and your credits too. If you buy some credits, you want to be able to use them on each of your devices.
So buy a few extra credits because you're going to end up spending some making stamps, making stickers, making special images. It's really kind of fun to have those available. I have to say, I've been doing a lot of it, as you can see.
But it starts with 440 built-in stickers that you don't have to pay anything to use.
Right.
So you got a lot to work.
Yeah,
with,
and a lot of images.
Now,
let me show you real quickly.
People really like custom stickers.
Yeah.
Is making their own signature sticker.
That's what I was going to show you.
Oh, cool.
So I figured this out all by myself. It wasn't easy. So, in fact, you've told me that the easiest way to do this is to write it on a piece of paper and take a picture of it. And so you're going to do the easiest way. I'm going to do the way that I did it, which was kind of a dumb way to do it, which is, here, let me see if I can erase this, which is to do it on the computer. So I'm using Procreate, but you could use any note-taking app. And I'm gonna sign my name. Now, this can be saved out, and so most apps will, you know, if you do an image, you'll be able to save it out to your photo roll. So I'm gonna share artwork, and I'm gonna save it out. Do you recommend JPEG or PNG? Does it matter to you?
Either will work.
Either will work.
Yeah.
So it doesn't really matter. So
depends
I'm gonna
on how big it is.
Yeah, I'm gonna do ping only because maybe because of transparency or whatever. So I've now saved that not such great signature to my camera roll and go back into Procreate. PhotoCard, and it should I should be able to import it as a sticker. Is that right? So let me choose plus, and it's gonna say choose image, and this is the one I just saved of my signature, and there it is.
So first you would. Rough crop.
Talking to the mic here so we can get it right. So first I do a rough crop, which is means I'm going to just get rid of like most of the excess stuff. Doesn't have
and then,
to be perfect.
And press crop.
Crop.
And now it carries a block of white as it is now.
Right.
And if you were to put that next to some text or something,
it would overwrite it.
So if you now say edit mask.
Okay.
Now the first thing that you could do is to use...
I'm going to use
erase tool and kind of scrub some parts out of it.
Okay.
And you can zoom in and scrub out more.
Yeah. But that's a lot of work.
Forever.
Yeah.
So
let me do the pour.
Allows you to kind of do.
And then now you still are going to have to do some pouring in the.
Each loop.
Loops. But that's not so hard to do.
It's kind of a paint bucket tool like in Photoshop's paint bucket.
And it's smart. It kind of does a pretty good job. Whoops. Undo. You got to make sure you don't hit the ink. There we go. Whoa, undo. And there.
If you want to make sure that you don't accidentally do it, you can choose the scroll tool.
Scroll?
It's a safety tool.
What does scroll do?
It says, I want to scroll it and zoom it. And I don't.
Oh, but not. I've always wondered what scrolling is. Now I can pour.
Right.
All right, go back to scroll.
The scroll is
and get this one.
Very safe place to.
Whoa, undo. Thank goodness there's an undo, right? Go back to scroll, and I think I got everything. Maybe I should clean up this a little bit if I wanted to.
One way you can check it is use, over here it says view.
View.
It'll show it against white.
Okay.
And then this is showing with what we call a ruby lith in Photoshop.
So I'm changing the different backgrounds.
Four different backgrounds.
To see what the look, so I can see, you know, and by the way, it's much bigger.
White.
that's going to be fine.
Yeah.
I could clean it up, I guess, if I wanted to with the erase tool, but I think that's good enough,
particularly,
right?
You're going to put it against white.
Right. So it doesn't really matter, right?
Now say,
buy now I'm going to buy the sticker. Okay, it's 2 credits.
To store it on our server.
And it's stored. And now, see, I can put this right there. It's not a very good sticker. But that's how you do it. Show us, is there a way to do it that's a little bit better, Bill? And that's kind of neat, is I can do all of that. So you draw it on a piece of paper, right?
Right. You drew that in
Procreate, in a draw tool, yeah.
I wrote my signature on a piece of white paper here.
Right.
And
you're just going to take a picture of it.
I took a picture with my camera. My iPhone, and I open that. I see I've got it here on my iPad because I've on
right. Apple's. There are different issues, of course, when you handwrite it, and you can see that you're going to get some weird shadows and stuff in the picture. So, but we can fix that all easily, right?
So I'll go into stickers and say, make me a new one.
Okay.
And choose this one.
There's the signature
that I just made.
And I did a bunch of them. I did.
And I'll crop down to just the signature.
Yeah, actually, that's pretty good. Once you get that shadow out of there, it actually looks almost perfect.
Well, no, it's still not perfect. So I'll crop that.
Yep.
And now I want to get rid of the residual gray that's in here.
Yeah.
So I'll say edit mask.
Okay.
Pour into here.
Boom.
And here and here.
Look how easy that was.
Well, yours was harder because you had a lot of more loops.
A terrible signature.
Because I want to zoom in there. I want to be careful not to hit anything else.
Yeah.
I'll switch to scroll. So I can zoom in there really tight and now do pour into here.
Could you choose the pour color? No, it's just going to remove.
It's always pouring erase.
It's pouring
it's
erase.
It's the same as the erase
Got
tool.
It. Got
but
it.
But it's an automatic form.
Got
maybe if I really was picky, I could say, oh, let's pour some erase into this little corner.
Perfect.
Okay. You can actually press and hold on scroll to reset the zoom.
See, these little things that are really handy. I really like
them. So now I've made one that's just my writing.
Perfect mask.
And is that bluish? Does that look?
I
wrote it with dark blue ink.
Yeah.
I think it is kind of dark.
Yeah. So can I make
it? So then you can make it whatever color you
want. I can change the color.
Whatever color you write your signature with.
Oh, nice.
So now I'll say buy that sticker. And we're all set.
Look at that. Isn't that nice?
So now I can size it however I want it. And rotate it if I want. Use that in my card.
I think that gives you a better result, frankly, than if you do it on the iPad. But you'd have to choose whichever way you'd
like to do it. I actually think that writing on a piece of paper
is real.
It looks more real.
Yeah.
And you can also use your favorite implement. Maybe you're using a pen. Maybe you're using a Sharpie. Maybe you've got your favorite fountain pen. Whatever you want. And just capturing that. Or if you do a pencil signature, it'll capture sort of the rough texture of the pencil.
Right.
So I think the easiest way to make a signature sticker is to photograph your own signature and make a custom sticker and use pour to get rid of everything except for that.
Now, why it's important
that you not have that block of white is, see, now it can be against other things.
It's transparent.
And it won't wipe out that text that's underneath there.
I bet there's lots of little things you could think of that you might want to do. You could make a frame, for instance, to put around a word and make that frame be transparent in the middle. And there's all sorts of things as you start playing with this, all sorts of things. So give us some general advice on card creation.
Okay.
Like, where do we start? What's the process you go through when you make a card?
What I always do is first choose the picture.
Choose the image. Okay.
So I choose the picture. Let's get rid of this Halloween one here.
So Bill's going to choose from his many wonderful images.
Well, I'm going to choose from my
camera. I love it that
camera.
I can.
Okay, we've
yeah,
been.
Yeah, I love it that
we've
I can
been looking
take it.
At my wife has a Leaf, Nissan Leaf electric car that we're looking at replacing because it's getting near the end of its lease. We're looking at the different colors of that, and so I'll maybe lighten that a little bit and say done.
And we should point out. So, for instance, I've chosen a picture that's a portrait mode picture, and what's really nice about it, at first I was concerned. But then what I realized is it's a printed card, so you will hold it that way. But what's great is this doesn't change. It's the back of the card is still horizontal, so it just makes a printed card. So this is really a really handy thing.
Yeah.
And I thought I'm going to save this for when I need to send a message of support or condolence to somebody. This is kind of a pretty image that I might want to keep around. So is this photo, how am I going to save this so I have it for future use?
If you use it in a card, then it will be in your previous ones. If you say, choose a previous photo here,
right,
it'll be stored
in. It'll always be there.
Yeah.
And I can email it to myself as one way to use it. You don't have to use it with somebody else. You just email it to yourself.
So the flow that I usually use is first
pick a photo,
a picture.
Okay.
Turn it over, choose a stamp.
Okay.
So I'll just choose one of the built-in stamps here. I'll give you the pink rose.
Okay. And because it's my wife, I'm going to send her a kitty cat.
Okay. And then choose an address.
So you tap the address.
And most of the time, it's going to be somebody
that you already sent a card to.
That you've sent to before.
Now, you showed me a really great trick, so I'm going to go back and view my sent cards. Well, that's one, but I had sent you a card, and I want to send you, oops, I have to replace, so let me go back to view sent cards. This is the first card I ever sent, was I sent it to Bill. I'm going to replace my existing card with that, and you showed me a great trick, because let's say I want to send Bill and Sue a card.
Ah.
I was saying, well, how can I, do I have to re-enter this? Because every time I did this, I got a blank thing. And this is a great tip. You tap it and hold it.
And it'll keep the address.
It repopulates.
There,
and now I can add.
And
S-I-O-U-X. Oops, I didn't capitalize Sue. And let me go back here. And this is just like editing text on an iPad or an iPhone. And now. Whoop, I didn't. Now I have to learn to say done. You know what? This is something I'm really bad at. I don't know if that's just me or if there's other people, but always press done. And by the way, notice it. And Bill showed me this too. It was an uppercase and because it's, you know, I'm doing
a name.
But then it realized, oh no, it's a conjunction, and you replaced it. Is that logic you put in the code?
Yeah.
You're so smart.
Well, it has to look for space and space.
Right.
Because you don't. There's many. Names that
right.
end with and but aren't.
So tap and hold. From now on, I'll remember that when I want to modify an existing address.
So when you, many times you've got a card that you've sent to somebody else. And
right.
you want to send a similar one to someone else. So
yeah,
you,
I want to duplicate it. I do that all the time.
You call up, okay, here's a card. You call it up from view sent cards and replace. Now I've got this one addressed like that. If I tap here, I can address it to someone else.
Duplicate card.
And maybe instead of saying, dear Dr. Christensen,
name.
Maybe I want to edit that a little bit and say, dear Leo.
Let me show you an application for that. So, and I mentioned this to you, this is a huge untapped market, is people who send out autographs or, you know, celebrities who send out cards. Occasionally people will ask me for a photo or I want to send them a thank you note. So what I did is I created stationery. It's of my the picture I want and I'm just going to replace this.
Let me tell you a trick there.
There's a faster trick?
Yeah.
So let's do this. I'm going to choose my stationery. Yep.
If you touch in the top half, it'll give you the front of the card.
Yeah.
If you touch in the bottom half, it'll give you the back of the card.
What if I want both sides? It'll start in the back of the card. Oh, so it's going to start.
So you don't have to flip it over.
I don't have to flip. Save me some time. So this is just, this is kind of a generic. Please, I apologize if you get this card from me. But this is just kind of a generic one. And then if I wanted to, I could add, you know, your name and I could tap here and add your mailing address. And that would be a very quick and easy way for me to send out a card. And I think there are a lot of people who are spending more money right now to send out cards to their listeners, their viewers, their fans. This is a really nice and easy
way
to
card,
do it.
Every card you've ever sent is a template for a new
future cards. Yeah. So there you go. So you say, one more thing.
Yeah.
You might want to change the caption.
Ah.
Now okay. I did because I want it to be my return address, right? I noted there was no return address on my card.
So what's the caption? Down at the bottom of the card, there's another little field here. You can touch in the middle and type whatever you want for a caption here.
Look at that.
Right?
Now, that you wouldn't know unless you tap down there. I don't know how
or
I found it.
Or if you read the manual or if you looked at the teaching video.
I figured it out somehow.
But often, you'd like to actually put in an address there that would be your return address.
That's right. Yeah.
And as you could type it in each time. But you
right.
can also set a default caption.
Oh, so there's one that I could say, every time I want to do that. This should be my default caption. So I'm going to select all and copy that because I want this to be my. Now, how do I make that my default?
Go to settings.
Settings.
And
Display default caption.
Turn that off, then turn it on.
So you turn it off and on. So I had a default caption, but I want to use this as my default caption. You like that. I put a little blue diamond. Yeah. That's an emoji in there, just a little divider. So that's my default caption. So, by the way, that's not a sticker. That's just an emoji from the emoji keyboard. So you could put anything.
All of the emojis work in the text and in the captions.
Yeah.
And even in the addresses, but sometimes the address correction will get rid of it.
Yeah, and the post office may not want to see a lot of emojis in there.
The post office doesn't mind them in the name part,
right?
But in the street and city, all that, you put emojis there, they're not going
to
like it.
Well, and I wanted to kind of ask you that because when I use a handwriting font, they don't mind if I use a handwriting font in the address here. It seems like it could be harder for them to read.
Well, the reason they don't mind it, so I'm going to choose an
handwriting font
here, a really
crazy font. I felt bad for the postal carrier. I thought, wow, they're not going to like that font.
If you get too ridiculous, it won't use the ridiculous one. Let me see.
All right. So you've thought about this too.
Aurore.
Yeah, see, it's a little harder to read.
Let's choose something.
Make it really kooky.
How about party?
Yeah.
Okay. It says that's.
Oh, it won't do it.
Far. It won't do it. It'll use it. Roman italic.
Okay.
But
it was smart enough to say I can't. Yeah.
But if you do have a handwriting font, what makes it work for the post office? Is this intelligent mail barcode, not the dummy that's displayed in the app,
but the one that will be on the card
generated when I go to print the card.
Is that the whole address in that barcode?
No. What's in there is a class of service, a mailer ID, which is me, and an 11-digit destination code and a serial number. The 11-digit destination code, what's 11?
Zip plus four,
that's 9. There's 2 more,
which
is what they used to call a carrier route sort. It used to be that carriers got their mail in the morning and they got a box of mail, and they had to manually sort it into the order that it was going to encounter it in their route.
Right.
Well, now the sorting machines take care of that for them. When they pick up their box of mail,
it's already in order.
It's already, the one on the top is the one, the mailbox they're going to hit first.
Interesting.
And in order to
generate. So it doesn't need the address, really. It just needs the carrier route sort.
Right. That's right. Because of that, even if this is a pretty interesting handwriting font, they still can get, because of that intelligent mail barcode, it will get to the right destination.
Wow. That is kind of cool.
I've had to learn a lot about the post office
I can tell.
In order to do this job well. And a lot of it, I think of it as debugging, right? We
had
to debug the post office
because
we were getting damage on cards. And,
and
Murphy's Laws, it would always happen right in somebody's face. There'd be a gouge. And so we had to learn how to avoid that. And part of that is avoiding this whole room full of equipment that they call a facer canceller machine.
You want to stay out of there.
Go to the back loading dock so it can go directly to the delivery barcode sorter, BCS, that reads this, does a 280-to-1 bucket sort, and it puts it in the right bin, and then it goes subsequent sorts to get to other places.
So by default, to get back to this caption, there is no caption on the card. Is that right, by default, or does it say your photo?
By default, this display default caption is off.
It's off.
Okay. And if you tap here, you can create one.
Right. That's for one off.
Right. So What did you put on the front of this?
You could actually say what the picture is.
Okay, this is. Yeah. So I might say, my dog Poppy.
Right. So the original intent was this is a caption for the other side.
And if you've chosen one of my nature photos,
it does that automatically.
Then.
Yeah.
You don't get to write your own caption for that.
We're going to give credit to Bill. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, yeah.
But you can't override this. So it's only when you have a custom photo that you can do your own custom caption. Yeah. But being able to make a default one, in this case, has allowed you to put your title.
I put an address. And so when I'm sending out, and I do want it to be this for those cards that I'm sending out as photo cards, as thank you notes and so forth, it should have that information. So it does. And that's actually kind of nice on the bottom right there like that.
You make a brand new card?
Yeah.
It'll come with that.
Yes.
You can still override it.
I could do a new card. Let's try it and see. And I'll actually stick with that photo, but it's already pre-populated.
There's a technique that you just showed.
Yeah.
Which is if you want to keep the photo you have, you can, when it says,
do a new card while it's there.
You say new card and it says, which picture do you want? You can cancel from the choose picture, so it'll keep the same one. just tapping up there.
That's nice.
Keep the same one.
That's a nice tip. Yeah. So now I have a new blank card that I can send out.
Your default caption.
Really, really great. Yeah.
And generally, postcards don't have return addresses. That just historically, people haven't put them on. Maybe they're traveling and they don't.
Right.
They don't even really have a return address. But if you don't have a return address on a card, then getting the address that it's the destination address correct is very important. Because
right.
if it can't be delivered,
it's
it'll be
get
discarded.
Lost. Yeah.
The USPS will call,
will this
it, they
count,
call it a
though?
Nixie when it can't be delivered.
A Nixie.
I know all the postal jargon.
I love it. Will
okay.
they will
okay,
the they realize
canceler machine
yeah.
is a room full of equipment that's always this old Siemens equipment that's purple.
Yeah.
And because it's a giant room full of purple equipment, they call it Barney. So when I say I bypass Barney, they all snicker and they know what I'm talking about.
I love my mail carrier. Nancy, my mail carrier, is so great. And she must have a way to modify the carrier route sort because she says, I said, you come so early in the morning now. She said, yeah, I like to come to the areas where people are going out into busy streets to get their mail because I want them to have all day to do that. I want to do them to be doing that at night in the dark. Where it's more dangerous. I thought, boy,
wow,
Nancy, you are really,
really considerate.
That's so thoughtful. So she must have a way of modifying her carrier route source. She must have gone to her supervisor and said, I'm going to go to these places first.
She has it all there.
Yeah.
And she just
takes a chunk out
yeah. to get to that your section.
Isn't that sweet of her? I
yeah,
thought, I love my mail. I've always loved my mail carrier because they always bring you presents when you order stuff. Since I was a kid,
I'm always
for the
amazed
mailman.
The Postal Service can deliver something for the price they
Isn't
do.
Isn't it remarkable?
If I tried to go find a messenger boy to deliver that to
right.
you for 47 cents, I don't think anybody
five
would
bucks.
Do it.
$5. Nope. So if I put this caption as a return address, is that sufficient for the Postal Service to say, oh, that must be the return address? There's no standard place to put it.
I have, well, in fact, you cannot put it up
here. Yeah, it would confuse them if you put it here.
Put it up here.
You could. That would be the more standard place to do it, right?
This way works.
Talking to your mic.
I have put return addresses across the bottom in the custom caption
and got them back.
And deliberately addressed it to a bad address and got the card back.
You're great. You're such a programmer.
I just want to know if it works.
You try the debugging in every way possible. You make it fail as best you can. So let me go back to, so if I tap the top part, it's going to bring me back to the front picture. Tap the bottom part, it's going to bring me to the bottom part. And I'm going to say replace. So now I'm back to a card I've sent to Bill, but I can use this as a template for a future card. And we should mention, you mentioned at the beginning once again, this is so great. It is a little credit for, so people know how you did this, photo card by Bill and Sue Atkinson, but it also says sent by Leo Laporte on the date that I sent it, and that's preserved.
If you had a shoebox full of these, you could put them back in order.
Isn't that great?
And I think we've done a really good job of minimizing how much branding there is on there.
No, it's perfect.
Using photo card by Bill and Sue Atkinson is in a small type that most people kind of ignore.
Well, and it also, I think people are going to want to know. I think I sent this to my mom. She said, well, how did you do that? She can immediately see this is how it was done. And I think that's really a great thing. So we're all done.
Some of the things that people would like to know.
Yeah.
What if I want to put more than one photo on the front of my card?
Well, yeah, how would I do that?
How would I do that? And the way you do it, instead of having a huge, I use a more modular approach. Instead of having a zillion lines of code in here
right.
and complexity, what I'll do is make it so that what you do is, let's say I want to make a collage for the front.
Right.
Well,
there's
I'll
a bunch of apps out there that'll do that,
300
right?
300 collage
yeah.
apps in the App Store. I'll just grab one of them. One I like is Moxier Collage. Another, Pick Stitch is nice. You can choose pictures and drag them into a format and move them around and get yourself a collage the way you want it.
Mm-hmm.
And then you say export to the photo album.
So you just make a picture.
And in these collage apps, most of them have an aspect. So this is what's important. You want to fit the card, right?
Right.
So you should choose either, someone will call it 3x2.
3x2.
Other will call it 6x4. Same aspect ratio.
Right.
If you want a horizontal, and likewise 4x6 or 2x3 if it's a vertical, if you want a portrait.
So good to know. So it's The aspect ratio of these cards is 3x2 and
it's
whatever
exactly
multiple 1. Of that.
1.5.
And obviously for portrait, it would be 2x3.
Same as a 35mm camera.
Yeah, I noticed that because...
And the same as the original iPhone.
Ah, not the newer ones. They're
the original.
They're different, yeah. So that I noticed that because what was great is the pictures that I take with my fancy camera fit perfectly on the card. And it makes sense. You're a photographer.
You're gonna... DSLR fits perfectly.
Yeah.
So when I've got a collage like this and I've saved it, then I'll just switch back into PhotoCard and I'll say choose from the photo library and I'll choose that collage that I made.
Nice.
It'll fit perfectly because you did the 4x6.
But
so some people have, I see cards that people have like a square collage with gray on the outside.
Don't do that.
Choose
a 3x2 aspect ratio. Yeah. Another point is that means you can use any photo app. So you can use any app that you use to modify your photos, to add captions, whatever you want to do. You can do all of that and then save it to your photo roll and load it into.
Some people would like to add a wishing you were here on
right.
the front. And you have to have sort of big, fancy display fonts with drop shadows and sometimes even writing on a curve and all this. And there are, again, 300 apps to do that. So
why duplicate that?
Called Over.
Over is a great app. I love that.
And so you can write something on there.
Yeah.
And then maybe that font.
So they have all the capability to do whatever you want to do.
Right.
Why should
add
I mean, that's
some text
nice.
And thanks, Leo. And I'll choose
you know what's nice this is also a source of inspiration for creativity. Yeah, look at that.
Different fonts.
Nice. I like Over a lot.
And if I wanted that like that, I'd say, okay. Oh, and I might want to also change the size of it. Okay, so I'm done with that. I say done. And then I can save this card out.
That's fun. I like that
save
one.
Save it out to the photo library. And remind me later. And then I'll go back into PhotoCard. And now I'll choose the photo. With the text on it. So that way I can add text on the front, and there's so many different ways to add text that it's really better that we use this more modular approach of switch into your choice of your favorite text over app or your favorite collage app. And there's so many, I mean, there are collage apps that let you put the pictures at an angle and drop shadows and multiple pictures. And what I've done is I said, let's focus on doing what we do really, really well. Let's print and mail these really well. I make them big enough that actually when you put four pictures on it, you can still see it.
It does look good, yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
But that's the way you would add more than one photo on the front. Now, you can also have more photos simply by adding stickers on the back.
And as long as we're talking about that, let's talk about adding captions too, because while you can't add captions in the app to the front, you can add little voice captions as stickers.
So let's say I wasn't going to send this to you as a printed card.
You want to send an email.
If I was going to send it, I'll readdress it to your email instead.
Okay. There's a whole bunch of...
Now, thank you for reminding me about that.
Yeah.
Now you can even personalize it a little more by adding a voice note. You touch on the voice... It says voices down here. And you touch on a talk bubble here. And then you record into it. Hello, Leo. Thank you for helping me teach people how to use PhotoCard.
You're welcome, Bill.
Okay. Oh, I didn't realize that's what that did. So it's going to add.
Now I'll turn off mute. I generally keep.
Yeah.
And then I'll just.
So if this would only work in email.
Thank you for.
Oh, that's awesome.
You're welcome, Bill.
Okay. So now to send this.
That will only work in email for obvious reasons.
Well, yeah, the card isn't going to, the physical card is not going to talk to you.
Right.
I thought about putting, you know, could you put a QR code on it that people with their smartphone can look at? It's just too geeky.
Yeah, too geeky.
Grandma would never figure
Grandma's
it out.
Grandma's not going to do that. But grandma might click on it in an
but
email.
But when you send that as an email, then you'll see there's a voice enclosure in here. I'll send that to Leo. And if you were to receive it over here, you'd have that sound. So you can talk to up to a minute of high quality audio.
So cool. That's so cool. Now, what if, I know it's not time for my Christmas cards yet.
Okay.
But I'm thinking this is going to be how I'm going to do my Christmas cards.
Ah, you might like mailing lists.
Talking to the mic. So
okay. So when I want to just send it to a few people, I send it to one and readdress it. And send it again, yeah. Readdress it, and send it again.
But I have 100 people on my Christmas
card. But I've got 100 people I want to send it to.
Yeah.
And so I like to create a mailing list and keep it from year to year and modify it. So one of the choices in addressing a card is this one with two heads. It's mailing lists. So you can create a mailing list by going plus. I'll say holiday cards. Now I've got a mailing list named holiday cards. To add people to it, I go like this. The little plus here.
Yeah.
Add. Well, you have to be on my card list.
Please add me to your Christmas
card. So now you're in there.
Okay.
So you can go
just add them from your address book. Boom, boom, boom. I don't have to retype them.
Right.
Well, that's handy.
Or let's add.
Oh, this is great. This is actually much easier than what I do to send Christmas cards out. So for holiday cards,
now,
maybe you're sending out, I don't know.
What if you had a bunch of them someplace and you wanted to add them all?
Yeah.
Okay. So I've carefully added three, and I could have typed in a name and an address.
Right.
Or chosen it from contacts, or chosen it from recents.
Mm-hmm.
But what if I already have a bunch and I want to enter them all?
Right.
So I'll go to notes. I've got some text over here. So here's some text that says, these are some fake addresses here. April showers and an address in the United States. So what this is, these are a bunch of addresses. I think of as address labels, a name and address label,
mm-hmm,
with
mm-hmm.
a blank line in between each.
Right.
To distinguish them. And notice that some of them are email.
Right.
And some are postal domestic and some are postal international. If I take that bunch of text and select it, and I'll say copy.
Mm-hmm.
Now I get to go back into PhotoCard. And I was working on this list. Now, to edit a list, you can just press and hold on it like you would do to edit an address.
Right.
But instead of editing the one address, I'm editing the whole list.
Right.
When I say plus, now this is the trick. Tap in the big field here.
Okay.
The postal address.
You don't paste them all in there, do you?
Paste. Bing.
Oh, my goodness.
Nine labels were added to holiday cards. Yeah, no duplicates were skipped.
That is so awesome.
Okay.
Now, is that in the documentation? No.
Yes,
is it?
All right. Yes, it is.
Sue's so smart, because I tell you what, that's
and
really
there's
cool.
One more thing that you can do.
Okay.
Okay, so now if I say done, it says it's got two email addresses and 10 domestic addresses. It might say so many international ones.
Yeah.
And if you go to send it, it'll say send it to list. And I really don't want to bother all those guys. Oh, yeah. You ask me about copyright permission first.
Yeah.
And then say, you want to send
12 all 12
cards
right?
I don't really want
no.
to. But that's how I would send to a group. Now, what if I wanted to use the same basic mailing list next year?
Yeah.
Well, the easiest way to save it and keep it, I mean, I'll have it here in PhotoCard.
Right.
Sometimes it's easier to just edit as a chunk of text.
Right.
So you can go into the mailing list and choose edit, select all, and copy.
Oh, now you can paste it into a
now,
Word
let's say
processor
I
or
go into
spreadsheet or something.
I'm in my email client here and I say, make me a new email. And I
paste it. Yeah.
Paste there. All that mailing list is there in my email. Probably be easier to select from an email than it would from notes. Because notes was giving me all this.
it was trying to be helpful. Yeah.
And now I send that to myself, and I'll have it for next year.
Nice.
Next year, I'll start with a copy of this, and I'll delete some people and change
Great
some
idea.
Addresses. And if so, I've got.
You use email the same way I do as a database.
Well, yeah, I have. I don't
it's kind of like that.
A lot of emails here.
Yeah.
So I'll say, let's say this person is no longer on my mailing list, and I'll delete that. Now I have a list that's minus that person, or maybe I've changed some addresses. I'll go select all and copy. go back into PhotoCard. And for that next year, what I'll do is I'll make a brand new mailing list. I'll say, new mailing list, holiday 2017, save, and then I'll press and hold and paste, and that new edited one with the edited
addresses
comes in. So that's a good way to use a mailing list. Now, mailing lists are kind of an advanced feature.
Mm-hmm.
Most of the time, most people will be very happy just tap to re-edit,
right,
to readdress, and send it over again.
But I love it. You can do it. And now I'm thinking, this is how I'm going to do my Christmas cards.
And even people that are traveling, I've seen people use mailing lists.
Sure.
They got five friends that are keeping up with their travels.
Yeah.
And they always want to send to the same five.
Same five.
Friends.
Yeah.
So they make a small mailing list that's only got five people on it.
Right.
And they say, address it to my friends. Now there's...
I love this idea. And you can do that right from your iPhone. I love that idea.
Yeah. If I, instead of Leo here,
yeah,
I type paren.
You put like mail merge in there. No. You're a bad man. You put, oops, yeah, you got the fur, but not the st. So you put mail merge in here.
Uh-huh. First name. Now, those are all lowercase. This font shows lowercase
as
upper. And it has to have a space between.
Okay.
It has to be all lowercase. So first name, and you can do first name. You can do last name, or you can do full name.
Okay.
Now, so if I say, dear first name, now if I go to send this, so send it by, I got to change it to an email just so you can see it easy.
Okay. And it should come from your mailing list, or does it matter?
Doesn't. If you send by a mailing list, it'll still do the same thing. Let's just.
But it doesn't have to.
Right. Here, the reason I want to send it as an email so you can see the text.
Yeah.
So this is to Leo Laporte. It says, dear first name.
Right.
When I send that as an email.
Now it has
to
have.
It says, dear Leo.
That's awesome.
So a mailing list is kind of a little more advanced feature, but it's very handy when you've got a lot of cards. I see a lot of people sending Christmas holiday cards this way. Let me show you an example. Here's a funny one. So when you look at view sent cards, you can search on them.
Okay,
so
I didn't know that.
I sent one to my friend Ann.
I should have known. There's a search
and,
box there.
Yeah. And it was a Christmas cards. There they go. And I can call that one up.
Oh, that's pretty.
And
I now you sent that as an email because it has a voice note. Yeah.
Did I mute it again? No.
What a nice idea. It's a singing card. And you can send that. Can I also do that with an email list? I could send that out to a bunch of people as
mailing
well.
Mailing lists can have any combination of email name and address, of postal name and address, and international.
So it'll be smart enough to do the appropriate thing.
Yeah.
If it's just an email address, it'll email it.
And furthermore, when it's only got emails in it, it'll say, oh, there's no credits needed.
Nice.
So it'll send, and what it'll do, instead of sending one email, CCing everybody.
Right.
That would be
not a good idea.
So good.
It sends out individuals.
Individual email, individually addressed.
Very good.
And this part of it really has their name and email on it. They would not be able to tell that you did it by from a list.
Well, and also you're not sharing everybody else's email.
That's
it always bothers me when I see people do that.
Yeah.
I would love to share maybe some of these better cards on social media. Is there a way to do that?
Oh, sure. Let's say I got this nice card here that has a Christmas tree on it. That's one of my nature photos.
Yeah. Oh, that's beautiful.
And,
look at that.
I want to send this. I want to share this, say, to Facebook. I could say, share postcard. Now, on Facebook, it's a broadcast. A whole lot of people are going to see it.
Right.
So look, it hides the address for now, for
so
privacy.
Smart. So smart.
I'll say, share it to, all right, let's do Twitter.
This is
Facebook, if I don't happen to be signed into Facebook right now.
Scooter X in our chat
room
is pointing
this out.
So you
get a picture there. You can write a little text with it.
Yep.
And then you would say post, and that would go out.
Oh, nice. That's using the Apple share sheet. So anything that you have on an Apple share sheet, it will share to.
Yeah, now I've canceled that, so it says postcard not shared.
Right.
But you can use that with any of your social media.
You know what I like is how...
And that, again, doesn't cost anything. If I'm not going to actually have to print it, laminate it, put postage on it, and mail it, then it's free to you.
What I really like is that you've combined digital with physical. So you can still do all the digital things, the sharing, the email that you would want to do, but you have the physical capability as well.
Yeah.
And it's nice that you get both. Scooter X in our chat room pointed out, and I agree with him, that this program has evolved. Every year you do more. You add more features. You refine it, even more importantly. You're not adding features just to add features. You're refining it so that it is more and more useful. And I really think that what's great, and I'm glad we could do this video, is as you start to use it, as I see you use it, I'm getting ideas for more ways I can use it. I didn't think about it for my Christmas cards, but it's really great. It'd be great for that.
One of my customers said, well, I have a lot of friends that I know their email, but I don't really know their postal address.
Right.
So I added a feature, and this feature is offer printed card with emails. What does that mean? If you check that, it warns you, with each email, include an offer for a printed card.
In the email?
In the email. And it says, your PhotoCard account will only be charged for those gift cards that actually get redeemed. So now I'm going to send an email to you.
That's brilliant. And there'll be a button in the email that says, would you like a print?
If I go to send that by email, it says, Bill Atkinson has offered you a gift. To receive a free printed version of this postcard, tap here. And you get a form where you could fill in your address.
That's so cool.
When you do fill in your address, you get a check mark whether you want to share it with Leo or not.
I could actually have that added to my contact list.
It'll send you back an email saying, this person has redeemed your postcard, and here's the mailing address they agreed to share with you.
That's a really nice feature. I did not know that. I didn't have it turned on. I'm turning it on now.
You could send to a list of 500 emails. And if only 10 of them wanted the printed card, you would only get charged for the 10 that wanted it.
Right. Let's look quickly through the settings since we've got the settings open. Are there any other features this is really typical. I think a lot of people use software this way. That offer printed card with email switch has been sitting there. I just never even thought about it. Now I've switched it on. So whenever I send out an email.
You turn it off when you don't mean to have it on. It actually costs you 2 credits every time they redeem one.
Right, but it'll warn me, so I don't have to worry about that. Send larger emails means better quality, I presume.
Right, yeah. The larger emails is 960 pixels across.
Okay.
And the older one is only 720. Just if you're on a low bandwidth communication, if you're not on Wi-Fi and not on... you're in some really old 3G or something like that, maybe you might want to turn that on. Just might turn off the send larger, which defaults on, just to make them a little faster to send.
So you control things like address correction. Again, there's a limitation. That only is in the U.S. The address correction only works in the U.S.
When would you turn off address correction? Let's say I put in an address, and I'll say, John Doe... And he's at 123456 Main Street. And the zip code for Los Gatos is 95030. And I say done. It says, incorrect address. 123456 Main.
Doesn't exist.
And I say it may be an undeliverable address because no match was found. So it's actually gone out to an online database, looked it up. And I give you the option of, I know what I'm doing. Keep it.
Okay.
And we will mail the card as you addressed it.
Right.
Or edit allows me to go back in there and change that a little bit. Oh, it wasn't 123456.
Right.
It was just 123. Uh-huh. And there actually is a 123 Main Street in Los Gatos. Now, if I say done, it's fixed.
It does work.
It knows that it's East Main Street, by the way.
Wow, it added East. Yeah. Wow.
So sometimes... it's changing your address in a way that you don't like.
Right.
And what you can do is temporarily turn off address correction. Now, whatever you type in, it's not going to complain. It's not going to change it. It's not going to do anything to it. It'll send it through that way. But I would recommend most of the time leaving that turned on so that you can know if you type in a bad address.
You do everything you can to make sure people get their cards, and I think that's really, really great.
Well, it's important. These cards are important to people. They're precious things. It's not, you know, when somebody loses a card or doesn't get it, it's usually like grandma that doesn't get it.
Yeah.
A lot of older people receive these cards, and I know one family sends them to their grandmother or to their mom, who's in early stages of Alzheimer's.
Uh-huh.
And they would go and visit, and she wouldn't recognize her own son. So they send cards where there's got a picture of the son and the back info, and these are his two children.
Oh, wow.
And so she's got this little
And when they come visit, she can kind of look at them. Well, and
not just before she visits, but actually throughout the week, she's looking at
just
them.
Just to remind
her. What could be more important to a mother than your children?
Yeah.
And being able to hang on to those memories.
Oh, wow.
Is really important.
That's neat.
So those cards, if they didn't get there, that would be terrible.
How many cards a day do you see? They all have to go through you, right?
Yeah. I pull them down and I lay them up, this giant PDF, and I send it to my printing partner in
This is pretty manual. Do you anticipate at some point having it be more automated?
Well, it is all automated on a timer, and I oversee it in order to be able to intervene and do better than the automated thing can do. Many times the automated address correction can't find the correct address.
Yeah.
Yet if I go to PeopleSmart or Spokio, I can actually find it. And
Actually do that?
Yeah. And I sent him a polite little email saying you might want to fix this in your contacts for next time.
That's pretty personalized service. I'm impressed.
Well, here's how I justify it. It's not at all justifiable on a economic point of view.
Right.
But I think about the person receiving the card. I think about the smile. I think about what they're. Wow, I got this tangible gift in my hand.
That's neat.
And imagine that person standing next to me while I'm doing this address correction.
Wow.
Well, of course I would do it, right? And so even if the text wrap's funny and it's going underneath the sticker, I'll go in and fix it up a little bit. Wow. At a return.
You told me occasionally you look at a photo and say, maybe brighten that up a little.
Yeah. Well, oftentimes people are choosing a photo in bright sunlight and they can't see that it's too dark.
Right.
On my calibrated display, I can easily see that this is going to print too dark. They're not going to be happy with it. And I'll fix it for them. And what I get is people saying, oh, your printing is so great. It's so beautiful. And I don't tell them, well, I fixed your card. Your picture was too dark. Probably why the biggest reason why I don't say that to people is when we get to 10,000 cards a day.
You won't be able to do that.
You may not be able to do it.
Yeah. How many are you doing now?
This morning I did 411.
411.
It's actually gone up a little since your interview with me.
I want it to go up more.
On the 4th. It needs to be much higher in order for it really to be worth my printing partner's while.
So Progressive is kind of underwriting this a little bit.
They are, they give me forward pricing from the get-go. It used to be that we would get 8 cards in a day.
Right.
It's not worth them firing up the printer for that.
Right.
So this isn't just a printer. This is a huge Indigo digital press.
Right.
And so today's batch will probably be run on the Indigo 10,000, which has 30-inch sheets.
Wow.
And so it can do 9 right. cards on a sheet.
Right.
Sometimes they use a smaller printer that can only do 4 up. So I actually send them the PDF in 4 up and in 9 up versions.
Just
so they can use whichever printer is available. Yeah. One of the nice things about the new one, the bigger one, is it has an auto-feed laminator. The smaller printer, human beings have to feed sheets of 4 cards apiece into a roller laminator.
Wow.
And
that's pretty labor-intensive. Wow.
400 cards on 4 sheets up is 100 sheets have to be fed in. And that cuts down, you know, roughly by a factor of 2 if it's the big one. And also it's an auto-feed, so...
Well, we should thank not only Bill Atkinson, but Progressive Solutions in Oakland
San Jose
for making this possible. And it is a great printer, by the way. The image quality, you'll be very happy to have a print like this.
I'm a color management nut. I'm really expert at color management, and I tried to make a better profile for their printer. I couldn't beat HP's. HP knows their stuff in color management.
It's a beautiful. So this is a card that I sent Bill of a picture we took on set when Bill was here last time. And there's something about it. You're right. The physicality of it is really fantastic. And I'm just very grateful that you have made this program for us to use. And I want to support you in getting more people to use it?
That's really what we need.
What would be the break-even point where you could really say, okay, now this is flowing? Do you like to get 1,000 a day?
If we got to 5,000 a day, I could hire somebody to make an Android version and make a web version so that more people could have it.
It would snowball
right
after
now,
that.
It doesn't make any money. Yeah. We've been doing it 7 years, and we've not made...
It's a labor of
love.
We've
not even paid ourselves a salary.
Yeah.
So to hire an Android programmer, they actually would want to get paid.
Crazy people. I don't understand.
So I figure, you know, I'm 65. I've got maybe another 15 or 20 good years before my warranty expires.
Yeah.
And maybe I have to deal with Alzheimer's, and maybe I have to deal with some major medical. What I want to do in that time is get this to be self-sustaining, get a lot more people using it, because it's about that emotional touch. When somebody gets this and it warms their heart, that's a good thing in the world. It's worth doing. And so I want that to happen. I want a lot more people to be using it. I want there to be versions for Android and the web. And I want a small team in place to carry on. So that, I mean, right now, if I died in a car crash on the way home, no more cards would get sent.
You better not.
Not. It feels a little bit like if you have a word processing document and you've been typing a long, long time and you haven't ever saved it.
It hasn't been saved.
That's sort of what it feels like. I want to back up this project so that it continues and carries on after I'm gone.
Well, I want you to, because now that I'm hooked on this, I want to be able to keep doing this for another 20 years too. This is really a great way. And, you know, you said something at the beginning, which I think is so important, is that this is what's going to last. The email you send is disposable. Even the stuff that you've put on a hard drive or on photos on the Apple servers or the Google servers is disposable. This is something that will last and will outlast you, and that your kids and grandkids might be looking at.
And think about your Facebook messages. Somebody sent you a nice Facebook message, but before you go back to even show it to your wife,
it's gone.
Scrolled off.
Those bits are disappeared.
And so things get forgotten that scroll off.
Well, what it reminds me of is I want to send more of these, because there's stuff I do want to make sure, images I want to keep and thoughts I want to preserve, that I want to start sending more of these.
I actually see a fair number of cards that people have sent to themselves. And they didn't even bother to write a message. They just put their address on it. They wanted a print.
Yeah.
They wanted a big, beautiful print for $1.50 delivered.
That's a good deal. That's actually a very good deal. Bill Atkinson, again, if you are own an iPhone or an iPad and it sings on the iPad Pro, if you've got the big screen, this is just a wonderful app to work in. It's very touch native, very easy to use. It's free to get, free to send emails. Go out and buy some credits, though, because you're going to want to make some stamps and some stickers, and you're going to want to start sending these cards and get them printed out because they're beautiful. Bill, thank you so much for making just a fantastic application. And I'm really glad we could spend some time, because the more I see you use it, the more I see how I can use it, the more I want to use it. And I think that's really important.
And that's what this could do for other people.
Yeah. Thank you, Bill Atkinson.
I think
again,
it's my best work. It's taken a lot more of my life and time than QuickDraw, MacPaint, and HyperCard rolled together.
Yeah.
I've had to write not only the app, but I had to learn Objective-C to do it. I had to learn the whole development environment. But I also had to write the server. So I had to learn how to write server code and Python for that. And then I had to write the production software that interfaces with the Progressive and generates this PDF. Even the software to track the intelligent mail barcodes. And so it's been something I've attacked and gotten into deeper and deeper, but it's something worth doing, and that's why I put the effort in. And I hope that enough people find out about it and use it to make it worth all the love that I poured into it.
Nice. Well, go out and make some cards and print some cards. And you can email me your cards if you want to share them with me at leo@twit.tv. I'd love to see the cards you're making. Bill gets to see them, but I don't get to see them. So I'd like to see what some people are doing.
So once you send a card, just tap the address, readdress it to Leo's EO,
send it to
Leo's
me too.
Email,
yep.
And send him a copy.
And maybe we'll share some of these on future episodes of our shows. Thank you, Bill Atkinson, for everything you've done.
Thank you, Leo.
I appreciate it. And thanks for joining us on this special edition, Triangulation.